entertainment.
One of the hallmarks of the 21st century is that we are all having more and more interactions with machines and fewer with human beings. If you've lost your white-collar job to downsizing or to a worker in India or China, you're most likely a victim of what economists have called technological unemployment. There's a lot of it going around, with more to come. At the vanguard of this new wave of automation is the field of robotics. Everyone has a different idea of what a robot is and what they look like, but the broad, universal definition is a machine that can perform the job of a human. They can be mobile or stationary, hardware or software, and they are marching out of the realm of science fiction and into the mainstream.
The story will continue in a moment. The age of robots has been anticipated since the beginning of the last century. Fritz Lang fantasized about it in his 1927 film Metropolis. In the 1940s and 50s, robots were often portrayed as household help.
Yeah, take your hat and coat.
And by the time the Star Wars trilogy arrived, robots with their computerized brains and nerve systems had been fully integrated into our imagination. Now they're finally here, but instead of serving us, we find them competing for our jobs. And according to MIT professors Eric Brynjolfsson and Andrew McAfee, one of the reasons for the jobless recovery.
Our economy is bigger than it was before the start of the Great Recession. Corporate profits are back. Business investment in hardware and software is back higher than it's ever been. What's not back is the jobs.
And you think technology and increased automation is a factor in that?
Absolutely.
The percentage of Americans with jobs is at a 20-year low. Just a few years ago, if you traveled by air, you would have interacted with a human ticket agent. Today, those jobs are being replaced by robotic kiosks. Bank tellers have given way to ATMs. Sales clerks are surrendering to e-commerce.
I'm an automated system that can...
And switchboard operators and secretaries to voice recognition technology.
There are lots of examples of routine, middle-skilled jobs that involve relatively structured tasks, and those are the jobs that are being eliminated the fastest. Those kinds of jobs are easier for our friends in the artificial intelligence community to design robots to handle them. They could be software robots, they could be physical robots.
What is there out there that people would be surprised to learn about in the robotics area, let's
sure.
say?
There are heavily automated warehouses where there are either very few or no people around. That absolutely took me by surprise.
It's on display at this huge distribution center in Devens, Massachusetts, where roughly 100 employees work alongside 69 robots that do all the heavy lifting and navigate a warehouse maze the size of 2 football fields, moving 10,000 pieces of merchandise a day from storage shelf to shipping point faster and more efficiently than human workers ever could.
We think it's part of the new American economy.
Bruce Welty is CEO of Quiet Logistics, which fills orders and ships merchandise for retailers in the apparel industry. This entire operation was designed around the small orange robots made by a company outside Boston called Kiva, and can now be found in warehouses all over the country.
Now, this is the order that she's filling, right, on this screen?
Yes. In a typical warehouse, she'd have to walk from location to location with a number of totes, and that's the innovation here, is that the product comes to her.
And all of this is pre-programmed? Nobody has to sit there and tell these robots where to go?
No, it's all done with algorithms. A lot of mathematics, a lot of science that went into this.
Customer orders are transmitted from a computer to Wi-Fi antennas that direct the robots to the merchandise, guiding them across an electronic checkerboard with barcodes embedded in the floor panels. Once the robot arrives at its destination, it picks up an entire shelf of merchandise and delivers it to the packing station. It then speeds off to its next assignment.
They know if they need to get from point A to point B, and they're not carrying anything, they can go underneath the grid. We call that tunneling, so they're very smart.
You'd think they'd run into each other.
Yeah, you'd think that, but it never happens.
If you had to replace the robots with people, how many people would you have to hire?
Probably 1.5 people for every robot.
So it saves you a lot of money.
Yes.
And it's not just going on in warehouses. El Camino Hospital in California's Silicon Valley has a fleet of robots called tugs that ferry meals to patients, medicines to doctors and nurses, blood samples to the lab, and dirty linen to the laundry. A hospital spokesman told us the tugs are supposed to supplement nurses and hospital staff, not replace them. But he also believes that robots and humans working together is the beginning of a new era. Robots are now wielding scalpels for surgeons, assisting in the most delicate operations, allowing them to see and snip their way through prostate surgeries with minimal damage. And they've begun filling prescriptions in hospital dispensaries and local pharmacies. Economic evolution has been going on for centuries, and society has always successfully adapted to technological change, creating more jobs in the process. But Eric Brynjolfsson and Andrew McAfee of MIT think this time may be different.
Technology is always creating jobs, it's always destroying jobs, but right now the pace is accelerating. It's faster, we think, than ever before in history. So as a consequence, we are not creating jobs at the same pace that we need to.
And we ain't seen nothing yet.
The changes are coming so quickly, it's been difficult for workers to retrain themselves and for entrepreneurs to figure out where the next opportunities may be. The catalyst is something called computer learning, or artificial intelligence, the ability to feed massive amounts of data into supercomputers and program them to teach themselves and improve their performance.
What's the weather like today?
It's how Apple was able to create Siri, the iPhone robot.
Here's the weather for today.
And Google, its self-driving car.
We've been amazed at how rapidly this has been happening.
This is Jeopardy!
IBM's deep QA system that plays Jeopardy. We had a contest here to pit against our best MIT students, the best Harvard students we could put it up against, and not surprisingly, Watson won, and it's being used in real practical applications now on Wall Street and in call centers. Siri, millions of people are using that every day.
The fact that computers can now understand and respond to human speech, the fact that they can actually generate prose of decent quality, they can drive cars, they can win at Jeopardy. We're seeing technology demonstrate skills that it's never, ever done before.
And it's putting new categories of jobs in the sights of automation, the 60% of the workforce that makes its living gathering and analyzing information. This piece of software, called eDiscovery, is now used by law firms in the discovery portion of legal proceedings, a job that used to require hundreds of people sifting through boxes and boxes of documents. We now have robots gathering intelligence and fighting wars, and robot computers trading stocks on Wall Street. It's all part of a massive high-tech industry that's contributed enormous productivity and wealth to the American economy, but surprisingly little in the way of employment.
We absolutely are creating new jobs, new companies, and entirely new industries these days. When Eric and I go out to Silicon Valley and look around, the scale and the pace of creation is astonishing. What these companies are not doing, though, is hiring a ton of people to help them with their work.
Because they don't have them? Because they can't find them?
Can't find everyone they need, but they don't need that many people to work in these incredibly large and influential companies. To make that concrete, Apple, Amazon, Facebook, and Google are now all public companies. Combined, they have something close to $1 trillion in market capitalization. Together, the four of them employ fewer than 150,000 people, and that's less than the number of new entrants into the American workforce every month.
And it's roughly half the number of people that work for General Electric. Ironically, one of the few bright spots is a modest rise in U.S. manufacturing, an early casualty of automation that is making a comeback because of it. This Tesla factory in California turns out battery-powered cars using state-of-the-art robots that can change tools and perform a multitude of different tasks, negating some of the advantages of moving jobs offshore. Annual investment by U.S. manufacturers in new technology has increased almost 30% since the recession ended, and research institutions and robotics companies funded by venture capital are constantly searching for innovations like the Roomba vacuum cleaner.
Traditional robots inside factories.
That was the brainchild of Rodney Brooks, a pioneer who ran the artificial intelligence lab at MIT before launching iRobot, one of the most successful robotics companies in the U.S. This is his latest progeny, a friendly, affordable chap named Baxter.
It's meant to be able to go in a factory where they don't have robots at the moment. and ordinary workers can train it to do simple tasks.
Mm-hmm. Such as?
Well, a simple one is for instance, picking stuff up off a conveyor belt. So it's going to go down and find the object and grab it and bring it over and put it to another spot.
Baxter costs $22,000 and can be trained to do a new task by a coworker in a matter of minutes. It can also be upgraded like an iPad with new software as new applications are developed.
And when you're training it...
Brooks and investors in his new startup, Rethink Robotics, see a potential market worth tens of billions of dollars and believe that Baxter could help small U.S. manufacturers level the playing field against low-cost foreign competitors.
If you're using robots to compete with the simple tasks that a low-paid worker does in a foreign country, you can bring it back here and do that task here.
Baxter costs $22,000.
Yep.
How long does he last?
Well, it's 3 years.
3 years.
So you can think of that as 6,500 hours.
I think it works out to about $3.40 an hour.
About that, yeah.
Right?
Yeah. Yeah.
$3.40, that's probably the wages of a Chinese worker.
Just
right?
About right there now.
So here, you could buy one of these robots. It would be like any Chinese worker.
In a manner of speaking.
That strategy has already had some success at Adept Technology, the largest manufacturer of industrial robots in the country with a wide and varied product line. John Dolcinas is the CEO.
So this is our flagship product. This is our Cobra robot. This is the class of robot that was used to automate Philips electric shavers.
The robots at the Dutch company's factory in the Netherlands proved to be so efficient and economical that Philips decided to move its main shaver assembly line out of China and back to Holland.
I think that those workers in China and India are more in the bullseye of this automation tidal wave that we're talking about than the American workers.
But even if offshore manufacturing returns to the U.S., most of the jobs will go to robots.
When I see what computers and robots can do right now, I project that forward for 2-3 more generations. I think we're going to find ourselves in a world where the work, as we currently think about it, is largely done by machines.
And what are the people going to do?
That's the $64,000 question. Science fiction is actually my best guide because I think we are, in that time frame, going to be in a very weird, very different place.
It brings to mind Stanley Kubrick's 2001 A Space Odyssey and the rebellious computer robot Hap. Technologically speaking, we are just about there.
Open the pod bay doors, Hal.
I'm sorry, Dave. This mission is too important for me to allow you to jeopardize it.
Everyone agrees that it's impossible now to short-circuit technology. It has a life of its own, and the world is all in for better or for worse.
Stop, Dave.
We wanted to leave you on this positive note.
One thing that Andy and I agree on is that we're not super worried about robots becoming self-aware and challenging our authority. That part of science fiction, I think, is not very likely to happen.
Future is only for the skillful person.
Say it again.
Future is only for skilled person, highly skilled person.
So,
jobs not for the ordinary person. You will have to.
So you are kind of breaking down the complexity of the job, correct? Isn't that what you're saying? Okay. And go ahead, Phil.
I think one of the major issues was what's going to happen to the people as jobs become more automated. What are they going to be doing in the future?
business side, I love all the technology and how it can help raise profits.
You all love the technology.
Yeah.
I have difficulty keeping your eyes on me. You are on your cell phone. That guy in the back there can't take his eyes off his computer. I really like your attention. So, what do you think of this film? You didn't see most of it, so.
I would raise my hand, but Brian didn't do it.
Have you seen it? Have you seen this thing?
Oh, no, I haven't seen it. It's my first time watching that.
I'll give you the video, so don't worry about it. I don't have to repeat it, it has it there. Mm-hmm. What do you guys, come on, a little bit more, and let's talk a little bit more about, a little bit more of this, and then we'll continue, yes.
People and machines working together.
We call it web man-machine synergy. My PhD dissertation was man-machine planning systems. I graduated in 73. How can someone be so old, correct? Yes.
Is there a system put in place just in case the machines fail?
A little bit louder.
Is there a system put in place just in case the machines fail?
So control of the controls.
Yeah. Like, do we have machines by standard?
You are beating me here to the thinking here. Control of the controls. Okay, let's just talk about some details of this film, because they are rich, okay? The thing that kind of strikes me more is the warehouse. And have you thought about the technology they have there? First, the robots, do they look like little people? No, they look like little boxes. Right. And how are they controlled? Huh? Yeah, but first Wi-Fi, and then barcodes in the floor to orient them. Okay, and then the whole factory is built around them. The warehouse is built around them with those supports that they can burrow under. So, this is our expert here on some of this, because she's doing IPA, Intelligent Process Automation, or Audit Process Automation, or Robotic Process Automation. And two components. One component is creating a Henry Ford production line. The next thing is optimizing the process. So you will not do the things with robots the same way you do manually. But that's kind of the step a little bit later. Let's continue thinking about this a little bit. I'm going to give you a number, and this is, I don't know how new this number is. The U.S. had been reduced to about 10% of all its manufacturing in the U.S. The rest went to China, Mexico, wherever. Now we are back to 14%, maybe even a little bit higher than that. Number of jobs, basically the same. Couple of other interesting facts. In the late 1800s, about 40% of the U.S. population did agriculture. In a few years, that went down to 5%. In the 50s, something like 30% of the US population did manufacturing. We are down to about 10%. Do these result in massive unemployment? She says yes, he says no. So did or did not?
It was a shift in employment.
Right, that's what actually happened. And the speed of the shift, like in industrialization of the Great Britain, where there was a lot of industrialization, there was a period of unemployment, and progressively, that unemployment was absorbed.
What is the unemployment level in the U.S. at this moment? 3.9. What do the economists say about that? We are in full employment. This is misleading, because the way labor economists count unemployment is people that are looking for jobs. 3.8 cannot find a job yet. Okay, but what the economy misled here is that they are using people that are looking for jobs. Some people just got discouraged and not looking for jobs anymore. And those are coming back because jobs became foundable. Other interesting factor recently, there has been close to full employment, still salaries haven't gone up. Very big. Now there is a little whiff that salaries are going up. Interesting. Now, if past predicts things, automation will replace a lot of professional jobs, and those people are going to be absorbed by some other things. What are the areas that you think that there will be more demand for jobs?
There will be demand for jobs that require analytical skills. Because robots can do repetitive nature tasks. Robots can do tasks that they can be told to do so, but they cannot make strategic decision making.
So give me some areas whereby you think there'll be more demand for jobs.
Something like the financial analysis? Yeah.
I don't think so. I think both Blackstone and BlackRock are both replacing analysts and kind of personalized custom care by kind of programs and decreasing the fees. Actually, my son works in that area, and I said, you're going to be robotized. Okay. But he actually kind of, when he made partner, they kind of progressively made him more in the sales area. That's not going to be robotized yet. Okay, so he's in Europe all the time. Actually, he's in London today. Yeah.
Humanitarian.
Say that again?
Humanitarian jobs.
Serial jobs.
Humanitarian.
Like what?
Like peacekeeping operations.
No. Peacekeeping operation. Going shooting someone in another country.
Developed countries to meet rural areas, but rural development, something like that. More like social science skills. There will still be jobs in social science areas.
Okay.
How about UX designers, user interface?
Okay. I don't think either of these is really going to be huge. There is one that's going to be very huge.
Marketing, psychology, maybe medicine.
Yeah. I think the American population is getting old. Okay, all the world population getting more. And there is a lot of personalized care needed in that kind of thing. So the medical field, the US already has 19% of its gross national product spent in medical care. And the population is going to age, I don't know how many years in a few decades. So that is jobs there. A lot of kind of personal services jobs. However, did you see what they said here about the hospital, those little robots, whatever, going around the hospital? They were saying, what did they say? The wordings they used, do you remember that?
They're
supplementing, they're helping. Mm-hmm. But that's just baloney, correct? What they are, basically they don't want the unions to start striking because they're being replaced. Meaning, if a machine carries a medication for the nurse, isn't there a machine replacing the nurse? Yes, no, come on guys, don't have to agree with me. Actually, I don't mind agree with you. Yeah, the knife, but the device doesn't shake. It attenuates what you are doing by a factor of 10 or a factor of 20, so it's very, very precise. You don't cut the wrong things and etc. Actually, robotic surgery is a very big field. Okay, so for example, you are here, someone can operate from California on you. They're still not quite there, but they're getting there. They already have plenty of experimentation. Now, area that's going to really take a lot of people is elder care, in general, medical, and et cetera, et cetera. And that's clearly increasing, and that's clearly very difficult to automate because it's not systematic. What are the easy things to automate?
Manufacturing,
which has a production line. Okay, and now they are talking about things that are slightly adaptive. It's not like only putting a wheel on a car and etc. They are talking about things that are taking some skills away, like people would do. Is that the other? Let's kind of talk about the other part. What was it? I remember the number they used was $3.42. Per hour, basically in 3 years, about $20,000 cost for one of those little robots. Now, what happens with the cost of devices like PCs?
Sometimes you gotta repair them, repair costs?
Oh, repairs, of course, they will be there, but people also go to the hospital and things like that. So. Repairs, I don't know how to compare yet, but good point. Yeah.
The price of technology goes down as it gets better.
Yeah. Well, meaning computers basically, their capabilities double every couple of years. Okay, Moore's law. Okay, so how much the $20,000 computer will cost in, let's say, 5 years? 5,000, something like that. But that's not also that way because you increase the capabilities, you make it do more things, put more software in it, but still go down. Now, the comment they made is this is about the equivalent of a Chinese work. But it doesn't go sick, does repairs, doesn't need supervision, doesn't have coffee breaks. Yes, no?
No.
Like a human being has. Doesn't argue with the boss. Yeah.
Also, to work more than 40 hours a week, there's no overtime pay for them.
Yeah, they can. And they don't want subject to labor laws. Yeah. Never know. This doesn't look too good, does it?
Professor, but I think that China is already getting, like, they're preparing for that industry shift. This revolution, because you know, like made in China 2025 policy they are facing right now.
The Chinese is getting robots, they are not stupid.
That is why Trump is saying that we're gonna ban students.
To stay away from politics for 5 minutes, okay? But yeah, that's of course, you know, this whole thing of trade wars and etc. is not only about trade wars, it's about productivity, it's about competitiveness, it's about three-way trade. There is a lot of facts there. But actually that already started happening a little while ago. You went from China to the inlands of China, and they are still doing that, going to Cambodia, Laos, trying to find lower areas for cost of labor. Yeah.
Now they're creating industrial parks in Africa.
Yeah.
And that seemed even worse than the way that we would have went from America to China to, like, just extremely low grade.
And there is a language issue whereby certain services, like operator services, you want to operate from English-speaking countries like India or like middle of certain areas in Ireland, and et cetera, et cetera. So there are the these factors. But what do you guys think? You think that robots are here to affect things? Is this a real phenomenon, or this is just kind of a life phenomenon?
It's real.
Is a very real phenomenon, or so-so? What do you think?
Robots definitely are going to, cover technology areas, but definitely not areas related to humans, where humans can function, like social skills, like humanitarian development, like I talked about. I mean, they are only going to be very limited to technology areas. I mean, doing, some kind of.
Okay, let me tell you a story. I was assembling the first, I was involved in putting together the first real computer in Brazil. And these were a computer brought in from the United States. The company was Burroughs, was the Burroughs 205. I was an engineer and I helped put it together. Engineer student at that time helped put it together. And what happened in that generation of the next few years, not only Brazil, entire world, is things like payroll, billing, power utility. I was in real life in power. The power utility probably reached a couple of million bills a month. Okay? And you had armies of people sitting over there preparing bills by hand. Hundreds of people preparing bills by hand. And in less than 5 years, most of those people were gone. Not necessarily fired, but they were not doing that. Okay? So was the kind of massive employment jobs that were replaced. And I think with robotics, we are going back into that kind of thing, where you employ a lot of people with reasonably not very large variance, those jobs are going to. Now, I don't think I am as pessimistic as Joshi and McAfee that this time this is not going to happen. I think this time it's going to happen again. There is going to be a rebalancing of workforce, and the workforce is going to move to other activities. I don't think it's reasonable to expect that technological jobs that build robots will occupy all those jobs. But there'll be other things. An aging workforce, maybe what he was talking about, more social obligations, more people involved in social welfare, and et cetera, et cetera. Difficult to say. Now, the thing that we really care about is, I'm going to put it in here, is accounting and audit. What's going to happen there?
I think the work of the auditor will become more easier and it will become more accurate as well, because nowadays what auditors do is they take a sample.
So you're talking about quality.
Yeah.
I thought, let me just question that a little bit. I tend to agree with you, but there was a comment here about quality of machine work, saying that, do you really think that robots do less good work than humans?
Well, in that example, it was in the Tesla factory when they put together the car, the computer just can't do that as well. But with the big data set,
I think the answer to that, and I'm speculating just as well, yeah. I think the answer to that is there'll be faults on what computers do. But I think in average, they are less bored, they are more precise. Okay? But there'll be faults on what computers do, and that will be part of Baxter. Baxter is a second or third generation of robots. And it's basically designed for the factory hands be able to train the robot on what to do. So pick up this thing and put it there and et cetera, and you don't need to write code, you just press a button and move his hand the way it should do. So it's like a second generation of kind of better way to teach. Okay, and these jobs, or pick this up and put it there, assemble this wheel, those things are kind of disappearing rapidly. That you have to do it 1,000 times a day. Can you imagine that these jobs in the past, you know, you're in a production line, 8 hours a day, and the cars keep coming, and you keep tightening the wheels and et cetera, or putting the the carburetor on with screws and et cetera. And if you are a little bit slow, the thing goes away from you. Well, those are not very good jobs. But that to accounting. Okay, the first comment in accounting is things like bookkeeping, like double entry, is gone. Okay, those jobs don't exist anymore. Who does it? Little robot? Yeah, software. Software. PCs that do bookkeeping. Correct? Where do you need some weights adjusting entries at the end of the period? And that only just a few times, particularly management wants to have some results and they are not getting it. That's not good, correct? But bookkeeping jobs, what do people do today? They go into in a smaller business, they go to a PC software, accounting software, and they say, I sold so many. And that thing knows what to debit, what to credit, and there is a menu of different activities that you need to do, and the job, learning that job, is not learning double entry bookkeeping, is understanding what those menus do. Peachtree, there is hundreds of these things. Now Vision, there are hundreds of these things. So some of these jobs are gone. Is that bad or that is good? Different responsibility for others. Yes, I think that's the answer. The answer is the job of an accountant is me. And you were never really trained for that. Professional accounting MBA is more oriented not for entering data on bookkeeping, but more kind of higher level type of things. Yeah, understanding business operations and et cetera. But is this scaring you? No. Not Anna. How about you, Brian? Are you scared?
No, and with your example they just gave about like QuickBooks or uploading and doing the bookkeeping, I went through that phase and I used that, but I also went back as a business owner to doing it more precise on my own because the breakdown a lot of times you can see the parameters and what kind of gets lost in the final number. And it helps me make better, I think, decisions.
So you started doing bookkeeping entries yourself?
I mean, sometimes I keep the cash flow, I'm not gonna lie. Like, that definitely helps me in organizing and...
But I don't think you are the example of what most people are doing. Most people have no idea of double entry bookkeeping, and they are very happy to have Navision or QuickBooks or whatever.
Most people just care about, am I getting a refund or do I have to pay?
No, you're talking about taxes, I'm talking about bookkeeping. I think that most UALs is unsymptomatic. You are not the typical little business owner, the guy who owns his two-person shop or the 10-person shop. They don't even understand where to book. In the past, they hire an accountant. These days, they hire someone to enter data on PC.
Process that where it actually will impede a business in a way.
What do you guys think?
When it comes to
Yeah, you guys.
I think I understand what Brian is saying, because it's almost like because they're just inputting the data and the software is making all the calculations for them, they don't have to understand what those numbers mean to their bottom line or their business, and therefore how they can change them to make their make more profit or something like that. So,
but it depends on the software. For example, you can box a lot of things. If you make a mistake, you have to figure out it yourself. And you just want to let you close the entry before you figure out the mistakes.
So, is accounting going to be automated or not? This part of accounting. He said yes. What do you think, Len?
I think it depends, because right now the data, the software is just need to some updates. Sometimes we download it from the bank, and then I will still need to fix it. Someone, the bookkeeper, need to fix it and finish the statement. So I think it depends. But for the tax return, definitely sometimes a lot of people have investment and start transactions. So you don't have time to enter all the information. Some people, they just they trade every day. So I think better have the automation to input the data. So it depends.
So Abby, we might need to send them a little article called Your Accountant is a Robot. and I will send it. And basically, what this is out of Journal of Accountants, one of these, talking about level of automation of the basic functions in accounting. You know, one thing to understand is these packages come with a lot of peripheral analysis. And by entering the data in the packages, you get all this analysis. Most of them, most people that use it don't understand, don't even know it's in there. But it's in there, okay? And maybe if you had a different package, you would have finished up using them. They come with a lot of, because you know the incremental cost for them to add this analytic is very low. So if they're competing, you know, like Microsoft has like, it has Dynamics, and under Dynamics is a series of things that they bought, like Navision and et cetera, et cetera. And so these things are becoming very interesting. And actually, it's kind of low-end accounting software. And now you're pulling the low-end up and trying to compete with the ERPs. And the ERPs, because they already kind of acquired the big companies, they are trying to come down and compete with accounting softwares. And the accounting software is expanding and doing human resources, doing other things. So that's kind of what's happening in the software. And at the same time that it's automating your bookkeeping and et cetera, it's creating other functionalities that take some brain to use. And I think some universities are even teaching that in undergrad. I don't know what we do. So I actually, we used to teach Peachtree in our AIS course. Okay, so undergraduate, we had one course in accounting information. You would teach that, correct, one of these days? One of the two of you. And you teach Peachtree there?
No, Peachtree is already obsolete. So we teach ERP or SQL. Professor, but did you watch Hidden Figures, the movie?
Hidden Figures. No, I haven't.
Nobody already watched Hidden Figure before? So when you see Hidden Figure, there's a main character, her job, and her team's job is it's a computer. Actually, they are computing. They're calculating numbers in NASA. So basically, those are the first computers. Actually, that was a job. But they were in trouble because NASA was implementing computers in their systems. And basically, what she has resolved the problem is that she learned Fortran, the language, computer language. And then after she, then after working NASA as a maintenance for those systems, because she knows Fortran. So they didn't lose their jobs, but basically their original job, which is a computing job, a calculating job, was replaced by the computer itself, but their job shifted into the maintaining part because they know the system itself and the language itself. So I think that accounting audience itself, like, now we don't need to do bookkeeping. But basically, who, so gonna survive is that who knows the system itself, like the system like Peachtree.
But you think that there were as many jobs as there were manual entry jobs in the second level of, you think they are the same?
I'm not sure, but like that is a hierarchy of the job itself, but I'm not sure it's the hierarchy of the job itself, but actually there's something to change for it.
Yeah, this is the same kind of thing is you create technology. Those companies that create technology have as many jobs as the jobs they're replacing? That's the question. And I don't think that, you know, in different industries, in different applications, the ratios are different. And I think that's the thing. And meaning I know at Real Light and Power, where we started implementing computers, got rid of payrolls and billings and et cetera, some of those people evolved to more technical jobs. Other people were just technically obsolescent, had to go and find something else. And in Brazil, they didn't fire a lot at that time, so they kind of redeployed them. But everyone's looking so sad around here. I'll tell you one thing. I don't think the next couple of years, the accounting markets are going to be very influenced by this. Okay, meaning the big four hiring and et cetera. But I think in 10 years, very much. They must have staff, the robotic process automation. We are just seeing how it's going to save hours, it's going to save many, many hours. And then the question is, are these firms going to do more noble work, or they are going to just stay what they are doing? And that's a very interesting question to ask. And I'll tell you another thing that I have observed recently is the big four are like maybe 65% advisory now, consulting. And the 35% still absorbing a lot of our students and a lot of the accounting students. The profitability of advisory is higher than auditing. So that is concerned. But I think the big four are reasonably stable at this point. Where the ones that are really worried is the next echelon, because they don't have the ability to invest the way they're large. And they are going to have to do some changing on how they operate. And there are probably two alternatives there. One, consolidation. Several small firms are going to pull together. We already went through it. And Big Eight, now we have Big Four. We had Big Eight, went to Big Five, and then Anderson went out of business, and so remained Big Four. And there was tremendous concern in the Department of Treasury, in the government, that this is an oligopoly, and it became an oligopoly, and needs to become more competitive. And so the small firms either are going to merge, or they're going to specialize. Certain kind of thing they do. Okay. Very, very interesting. I just want to kind of go down through here. So no question there is going to be automation. It's already happening. How many people are going to be hired is very difficult to estimate. One thing, however, skills are going to have to change with more IT, more statistics, modeling, deep learning, whatever. We need to convince the university that they need to change what they train. They are not worried about professional accounting MBA. I'm more worried about undergraduate curriculum, because undergraduate curriculum is totally directed to the CPA exam. And those skills are not going to be very useful, because most of those skills are going to be replaced easily soon. Quality. In general, robots and automation provides better quality. But obviously there are hiccups. Self-awareness, McAfee and Johnson were saying, no, don't worry about that. Worry about that, but not immediately. Okay, I mean, there'll be a day whereby machines will be very complex and accepted. And there is no reason to think that they are going to behave like human beings. This form of intelligence is going to be different. And things like we saw Stanley Kubrick's 2001 was basically kind of thinking that intelligence is being a human. And that's not true. Intelligence is the ability to identify and resolve problems and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, and doesn't have to be like a human. Okay, I don't think there is great worry here that like 2001, a machine will take over a ship or et cetera. There is big worry that some cyber security violation will allow someone to attack your self-driving car and do something nasty. But that's not a machine doing it itself, at least in the immediate future. Man-machine synergy, that's what's going to be. You're going to change a little bit your behavior to use that software, to use that great computational capability, and et cetera, et cetera. And I'm not sure if they were right saying that at this moment there'll be no absorption of idle capacity. I think there will be. It's just a question of how long. Meaning when the Industrial Revolution hit the UK, there was a period of functional employment. And then progressively it was absorbed. And I think this is probably likely to happen. In accounting and auditing, just to kind of concentrate in that direction, as I always say, the manager is here, the data is getting farther and farther for the manager, there are many layers in between, and there are progressively more and more layers. I call this piggybacking of applications. And what's probably going to happen is more and more need to assure that these applications are working properly. And the other part is more and more need to be data specialists, explain to management what the data is giving them. And that should be the role of the accountant and the role of the auditor interpreting. Assurance is going to be very big in the future. The interesting question here is, will auditors, the way you guys do it, or they are going to be consultants or someone else? And I think that has to do with the standards, how the standards are going to evolve. So that's kind of what I wanted to talk about this. I find it's worrisome and very interesting at the same time.
Sir?
Yes.
Do you think that robots will be able to take over the positions of higher management, positions like CEO or CFO, where they provide strategy direction to the company, where they take those decisions, and they set the direction of the company? Like, do you think a robot will be able to replace them? Do you ever see a robot as a CEO of a company?
Typically, the CFOs come in the financial track.
Oh, yeah.
Okay? And if it's management, if it's marketing or financial or production that takes over, I think it's more like personality than and history than anything. A company is kind of doing bad numerically and selling, the sales are going down, they typically push marketing. If the company needs better controls or they have a very charismatic CFO, that's what happens. And so I don't think that comes from necessary by confessional area that nomination, but this is just pure speculation. I don't have really any data to say. However, this is something that you need to think in terms of technology and think in terms of what we talk here. So let's go back to the internet trends of Mary Meeker. And according to Abby, we were, oh, why isn't this? Because this is a PDF file and it wants to go this way. Okay, so you remember what we did here. We basically talked about growth. And we said that basically growth has kind of flattened up a little bit, And do you remember the reason why? Because the markets got saturated. So India has growth, still Africa and South America has some growth. The other markets is basically replacement market. And look at this. These are new smartphone unit shipments. So stay basically stable. Are you surprised about this? But the growth went down substantially because there are not so many new markets. And you remember the big number here was about 3.6 billion people, larger than 50% of the population that are internet users. So who are these people that are not internet users?
They are normally in countries which do not have infrastructure, like which do not have infrastructure for internet and data networking cables, something like that.
Okay, they have no infrastructure. What else?
I was thinking about being peer, hiding themselves. How should they use it? They could pretend that they don't use it.
So you think they are kind of phantoms?
Yeah.
How about 5-year-olds? 3-year-olds. My granddaughter used it, but maybe the 1-year-olds don't use it. Correct?
Elderly.
Yeah, I think the elderly are using it more,
really.
But yes.
Some older people, they like to use a computer. Yeah.
They don't see their kids, so they use the computer. But yeah, I think you're right. I think some of the elderly, particularly when your eyes fade, then we talked about infrastructure here. There are places where there are no internet available. One more thing. If you make $2 a day in Africa, can you buy a computer? Can you pay for the internet?
No.
So it's very critical income distribution, correct? And then you might, if you buy a cell phone, you might not be able to eat for a week or for a month. That's not good, correct? Yeah.
I know in some cities, in developing countries, they have internet cafes still, where even though you don't own the computer, you can pay like a marginal amount of money and then use the computer.
Yes.
And still have access to the internet.
Yes, and they use cell phones as a form of monetization. Like you buy units of cell phone and pay things in units of minutes that you don't. Very common in Africa, particularly where in places where currency is very unstable. So you go and buy from your local telephone company, prepaid so many minutes, and then you pay things, and so it became a real currency. And that's actually more of a cyber currency than the other things that you are seeing. Because it corresponds to a real value. The real value is the minutes you talk. So that's actually happy. But it's interesting, look at the penetration, 49%. It's actually, I thought it was higher than that when the first time I saw this a couple of years ago. And I thought most people are in the internet, but half of them only in the internet. Major device is that you use is not computers, it's your cell phone, it's a smartphone, or getting in that direction. Okay, so this is the growth is difficult to find, and this is the kind of thing. Now this is where we stopped last time. We talked about how many hours you spend on the internet per day. And what you said, we spent more than 5.9 hours. Do you think you do?
Yes.
Why? Because you are a student part of the population.
I think it's just because that's just how society is nowadays. Like you have people who are more prone to be on their phones, doing every little aspect of their life while they're at work. While they're eating, even using the bathroom, you have people on their phone.
phone. So, so it's like we're always on technology, we're always using the internet. Just
well, going to the bathroom with your cell phone is good. It's a quiet moment. Don't you agree? Yeah, as far as you don't, it's very common people drop it in the toilet or in the, on the sink. Have you ever seen cartoons of people that told you that they dropped it?
I know some people who use their phone while they're in the shower.
I jumped into the swimming pool in my house in Long Island with a cell phone in the pocket. Okay, but the iPhone was good and then this is average. Okay, but look at this, the colors here. What do the colors mean here? Where is the legend? There is no legend here. I want to see what those colors mean. Oh, here it is, the legend. Okay, mobile, the green, desktop, laptop, the gray, other connected devices. So, and look at the other interesting. 10 years ago, cell phones were less than 1%. Now cell phones, well, it's not less than 1%. They were, I'm interpreting this one. This is actually ours. Correct? Is that what it is?
Yes, ours.
You think this is going to continue going like this?
Yeah. Might be worse.
Meaning they're only 24 hours a day. And you sleep about 6 or 7 or 8 of them. So we finish up with 16 hours and you're spending 9, 7, 8 hours of this in devices.
I think that's worth the shift. I think the other connected devices will be much more large in the future because now we are in the era of IoT.
So you're thinking about IoT. Okay, let's keep that separate because you will have the shirt connected to the internet. Your belt will be connected to the internet. My Fitbit will be connected to the internet. And so that's kind of a little bit of a different thing. You know, anyone with health problems is going to be all wired on the internet without being, being particularly constrained. Okay, so this is how much is too much? Depends how time is spent. And these are actually the innovation plus competition driving product improvement. So, devices, we already talked about that. What kind of access they get? How easy is to use it? This new variable payment, you're using it for new functionality in very big in China, much less in the US. Location, basically, and location, messaging, video, voice, personalization. Let's just go over these. Okay, so what's happening with the devices? So, number, this thing doesn't make sense to me. Because the other chart show, we're okay. Yeah, basically new smartphone shipments basically replacing old smartphones. And these are capabilities, water resistant. That's why I found out when I jumped in the pool with it. Okay? I actually find it cool. I just got my iPhone X, and I find it cool that it recognizes my face. And my granddaughter was very upset because her face wasn't recognized. So I have to train it. Google Assistant, like Siri, actually, what you are hearing these days is that Alexa and OK Google are much better than Siri. So there is a lot of pressure on Apple to improve the quality of Siri. And Apple is doing kind of a concentrated effort on improving some of the software they have. Now,
has basically location and etc. What's happening with Wi-Fi? Actually, I'm surprised. It has been, I thought it would be ubiquitous, everywhere Wi-Fi for free, and it's not. You have to pay like $20 to have it on a flight overnight. And here you can have it everywhere, it's obvious, but most places you don't have it everywhere. And why is that?
Security?
No, I think it's just infrastructure hasn't grown the way people expected. I don't think it's security. Security, there are issues, but I don't think that's the issue. The other thing is that, meaning some countries are just basically the country pays for Wi-Fi, and everyone gets Wi-Fi for free. Singapore is getting in that direction, several other countries. And the US went in this market model. That haven't gotten it. But look at this. Number of networks, a lot of Wi-Fi networks around. And these are startups like Square Cash, Spotify, and etc. I'm going to stop here. And if you have a chance, have a look at the slides. There are a lot of them. There are 360 or something like that. See what you can understand of this. And they give examples of applications and what they do. And look at this. This is actually very interesting. This is verbal recognition software and how well it recognizes words and has gone up dramatically. And I think most behaviorists look at this and say you need a certain level of accuracy for people to use it. And it got there. It got there. People are using basically desktop voice recognizers or telephone-based devices, etc. People using all over. I was sitting on an airplane, and there were these two ladies next to me. I was in the middle seat, I hate it. And they were talking to their cell phone. Alexa, no, Siri does this, Siri does that. And they started fighting because one was interrupting the other. And I was in the middle, and they're yelling at each other. Until the hostess came and asked them to calm down. Literally, they were with their cell phones, and one was interrupting the other. But I think the quality really has changed. Okay, and what do you have? You all know what the Echo is? Okay, let's talk for a second about Facebook and Mr. Zuckerberg's difficulties recently. You have been following this on the news, correct? So what has happened, and what's going to happen, and what did you notice on this whole thing?
Oh.
Helen, right?
Oh, yes. Basically, it's like an election, and they have some kind of collective data from Russia, and they try to have impact on the election. So this like a break of privacy.
Yeah, most likely it was Russia, but let's not worry about that. Was basically Cambridge Analytica that basically harvested. And what they harvested was a psychological profile tool that was sitting on the internet that people had collected the data on top of Facebook. And that data was shared and was used for analytic purposes. That was the big fuss about it. And yeah, probably was being used for political advertising. Of one side, maybe the other governments. But what's not said then? What's not said is that Facebook has given access
to the same information to tens of businesses that were paying Facebook for access to this thing. So if you use Facebook, and I'm sure that in when you go into say Facebook and you find sign I accept, it tells there that they can do that. Because no one reads that stuff, correct? Maybe Brian reads it. Did you say you read those things? And then you didn't sign, or you said, okay, I'll let them do it. You signed it, yeah, me too.
Yeah. I actually read like a while back that Facebook, like when you delete something, it actually never gets deleted. Facebook stores it. So like, for example, let's say a government agency wants to do a background check or something like that, or one of those hiding background checks, they can get access to all that stuff on Facebook.
Yeah, yeah.
It never gets deleted.
Yeah, meaning the government can control that you don't keep things online, but the government doesn't have the tools yet to control the right to be forgotten. Okay, and of course it's very difficult because what these systems do is they back up, they do incremental backup, and they do incremental backup and incremental backup, etc. And you benefit from that because sometimes you wipe out and you can go back one or two generations and recover. So that's good, but technology given, technology, take it, okay? Because you can go back, they can go back too and find out name of your five last girlfriends. Or the simultaneous five girlfriends that you have. Absolutely. Meaning, your relationships. They know where you're driving, you know who you are driving with, and they is very hypothetical. Facebook knows that, the cab records know that, the telephone company knows very well, because two cell phones, triangulation, they are close, they are people are together, and they are moving at the same speed, it's pretty clear. Waze knows that. Okay, so everyone knows it. But you are not very interesting, so no one is doing too much of that.
So this is like similar to the Alexa, the Amazon, they can record it, like the, all the conversation.
Yeah, there is a lot of concern about that.
Yeah.
And there are obstacles because have you imagined that every Apple device in the world are collecting voice around it? It's a big volume of data. So they must not be economics to do that. However, if there is a reason they want to collect your data, and now that's changing. Now that since Zuckerberg and Facebook is running into trouble, all these companies are rethinking. Also the new disclosure rules in Europe. All the companies are rethinking what they can do or not. Okay, but what I wanted to leave you with this conversation about Facebook is that don't be surprised, the revelation, meaning they were this company is there selling advertising and selling data. If they can sell data on what they're collecting by giving you the access free to Facebook, they will sell it. And they just didn't come clean and say, I sold to everyone everything. But they did. And what do you expect? They're trying to make money. Right? Apple has been a little bit better at protecting data. They have protected telephone data. They have been very resistant to the government on giving access to telephone records and et cetera, et cetera. But totally sure that Facebook have sold a lot of the data. It's not only Facebook. Facebook owns Instagram and WhatsApp. WhatsApp is an encrypted application. Not totally clear if there is a backdoor to that or not. Although, you know, the first thing is WhatsApp is encrypted, so you trust it. Okay, but WhatsApp belongs to Facebook. And Facebook have been selling a lot of data, correct? And do you think that the NSA has access to WhatsApp? We don't, correct? You can never be sure that some encrypted application hasn't been cracked. here, because we could go on for a long time. So remember, Maddy Meeker, this is her name, and she has been doing internet trends for 20 years. And her slides used to be 5, now they are 360. Every year they are different. Every year they do this background of how many devices are out there and et cetera. And then every year she kind of comes out new things to analyze. Spent a lot of time in the last few years analyzing Chinese markets. Now she's doing less of that, a little bit more of India. But she doesn't abandon things that she discussed. Okay. Okay, so this is a very old article from The Economist, and it talks about the real-time economy, but we are going to draw on this when we talk about continuous monitoring. We are going to draw on this when we talk about continuous auditing, and I think it provides a lot of insight. I see. Yeah. Aldo Ruggles has a better accounting department by far than me, I think. So this is very puzzling how this is going to evolve. I actually very surprised how slowly this has gone. But you know, I'm going to show you, not today, but maybe next time, what I call the 8 pillars of wisdom. And these are 8 little initiatives on electronizing or digitizing education. One of them is the library, which we have about 1,000 hours of accounting courses for free on the net. And when I showed, and we're getting 500,000, I mentioned it before, 500,000 minutes watched a month. And when I showed this to another department, they said, you have to sell this, you have to make money out of this. And that's the last thing I want to do, so I'm not going to do it. But it's a very interesting story of changing. Oh, where is it? Oh, I was going to steal yours. Okay, so what's happening? Organizations are digitizing the business, electronic the business, with new tools, re-engineering processes. How would you re-engineer this class to make it better?
All different forms of learning, meaning like you did a video in the beginning. You have the interaction right now where you're seeing it, you have the discussion, you have questions, maybe incorporate writing assignment in the middle of class, like a little one or two question thing, just to cover all the bases because we all don't learn the same.
Okay. You know what I usually say? I say, residential learning, learning where you come here and attend the class, is a big luxury. It's an expensive luxury too in the US. And I was in Brazil, and every public university is free. That's the good part of the story. The bad part of the story, 11% of the university students are in public universities. The rest of it pay. Now think about people that live in the university, like in dorms and etc. That's a big luxury. And I don't think that places like Stanford and Harvard will change that very much, but for the next 20 years. But many universities are going to have to rethink their model. And I think what you're describing, kind of different methods of experiential learning, etc., are going to come into being. Now, I always say, you know, this class is an advanced class, and it will be less effective. But things like introductory, intermediate accounting, managerial accounting, the basic courses, you know, there is these guys called Pearson and Magruder-Hill. And these guys, and they can afford investing $10 million in a course. So they can do incredibly beautiful job and then sell you textbooks at $300 or even more. And very difficult for a university to compete with them, because a university puts a professor available, but that's about it. Maybe Blackboard or something like that, and not very much. And so it's a very different market, the mass. And you know, if you think about Pearson, who pick up introductory accounting, get Tom Cruise to teach it. Very charismatic, very attractive, you know, have the smartest professors prepare the classes for him, and he'll deliver much better. I prefer pretty young lady, but that's a different story. But maybe they'll have two versions, a male and a female version. Maybe even several versions. Okay, I'm just joking, but don't take it too serious. Okay. But they will be able to amortize a course over 100 universities, the basic courses, that the ones in the big classroom. And I actually think what's going to happen is that people are going to stop coming to the large public universities and basically sit home and take graduates for these things, because there is no personal experience. Now, if you have an instructor there talking to you, helping you, etc., that there is value added there. And of course, then there are going to be these developments of how can an instructor help you remotely in a virtual reality world, and etc., etc. And that's going to happen. But this level of courses, like advanced analytics or AI or etc., they will take much longer to be commoditized, because the markets are much smaller. There is no way to invest so much money in one course. So that's my prediction. God knows what really is going to happen. But these were kind of reorganizing the courses, and the one thing is this process of digitization didn't really start with the internet. Just the internet accelerated it and allowed. The big thing that the internet created was internet working, whereby you use communication and you access things remotely. And you would not recognize what education was 15 years ago. Physical textbook, a lot of paper going around, no communication. It's a very, very different type of thing. I used to prepare pack of readings. Do you still remember packs of readings?
No.
You buy a textbook, and then the other supplementary things some organization or university used to sell them, and they copied it, or mimeographed it. Do you still remember that? Hasn't quite disappeared. Okay. And this is not that recent, but this is actually a nice little story of online sales. And look at this. Garden and building materials all the way down here. Books, films, and music all the way up there. And you see there is no education here. Where would education be? Does education get sold? Of course. And why? Because it hasn't really transformed very much, but it will be transforming soon. And the things on the top are what I call digital goods. Goods that are not physical. Now this is, have you been in New York City recently? Midtown? Every block has an empty store. It's like, I would say ghost town yet, but because the economy is very strong. But the moment the economy takes a dip, which always happens, is going to be pretty serious. And what's happening? Why are so empty stores?
E-business?
Retail is dying out.
Huh?
Retail is dying out.
Why?
Because you just
why is online shopping destroying retail?
It's more convenient for the consumer.
you buy cheaper.
Cheaper, yeah, yeah, faster.
Is it more convenient online than physical?
Save your time.
I have to tell my wife that. My wife can go to a mall, spend the whole day there, not buy anything. And she comes back so happy. Had a great day. Okay, and so we have a disagreement here, because if I go to the mall with her, I sit in the car, connect to the internet, and talk to Mochi. And wait until she comes out. I don't think I haven't gone to a store for years. Maybe now and then a moment of desperation in the airport or something.
That, but I've seen stores with you have different clothes and they kind of dress you electronically.
Yeah,
yeah, not little holograms, but I'm sure that technology will evolve.
You just buy from free returns. Companies offer free returns.
Yeah, that's what I do.
All the time,
I buy a good feathers, but I send it back if I don't like it.
This sort of ties into the same like heavyweight, like, oh no, another thing changing in our society. What are we going to do? Like the spear based thing, but. Again, I have friends of mine who are real estate developers, and they're converting commercial spaces, all the empty spaces, into condos or into different forms now. It's just, again, another shift.
Condos
the
and
the
residents. You know, people still can't eat virtually. So, but that is the delivery, the seamless of the world.
Don't you also think it's a little odd how Amazon, the one who sort of spearheaded the e-business in many ways, is now starting to slowly purchase some retail here and there and sort of build up on that front now that they sort of put the others out of business in a way?
Yeah, Amazon didn't put them out of business. Was electronic retail. And if it wasn't Amazon, it would be someone else. Correct? Meaning Amazon is about 50% of all electronic sales, but if you take Amazon, and the stores mounted on top of Amazon with another name, you got even more than that. And so I don't know, I think it's going to kind of flatten out and there'll be a kind of a return. I was in Dubai, and the malls are doing very well there.
I went to Dubai too.
And you saw
the malls,
everyone is in the malls. And then you realize the temperature outside is something like 110 degrees. And so you go in the mall, it's cool. Okay, and that's basically, it's like a center of social life there. But the malls in the US are not doing that well. Some of them are doing okay, other ones are not doing so okay.
What's the obesity rate in Dubai?
I don't know.
Is it big? Per capita.
Is it big?
Yeah? I would say that the Emirati population has a higher obesity rate per capita than the United States.
Really?
Than
the Midwest and the United States?
Oh, yeah, I checked it.
Per capita.
Obesity rate in Dubai?
Yeah, I'm actually surprised by that statement.
Can someone Google that?
I'm doing
he's fine.
Okay.
Okay, that's. But look at this. Look at this. United States Department store sales, that's what it was. And you see the bankruptcies. Okay. Online for the jobless life. United States.
professors of accounting too. I just asked if this is going to happen, professor of accounting too. This jobless line, low, medium, high jobless.
Is that the unemployment?
Online for the jobless line, United States retail employment at different levels and comp of e-commerce penetration. And low penetration, medium penetration, high penetration. This actual, and this was actual up to here. I don't have the numbers here. You think there's going to be a jobless line for professors of accounting?
Maybe
we'll
just teach online.
Teaching online, there is great economies of scale. You know, one teacher, many, many classes. And it's really kind of a different teaching, is whereby you really do individual supporting, not lecturing. You prepare a lecture. You know, Professor Sanella has these tapes he prepared, these videos. He is very intelligent. He does a beautiful job on that. And that's the kind of people that are going to get the jobs. I was joking about Tom Cruise, but I wasn't really joking. Meaning there are going to be people specialized on delivering a very clear, non-extemporaneous lecture, not like me. And it would be very interesting.
Let's see what's going to happen.
Okay, and this is actually how much storage exists in the digital universe. It's kind of incomprehensible. And mentions on AI. Now, AI, we are going to go back to the hype curve. Remember the hype curve? And AI is not one area, AI is hundreds of areas of application, and some of them are more evolved than the others. And there'll be a period that is going to be, you see, it's the same thing as I made the analogy of payroll being automated, except there'll be a set of jobs that you can do robotic process automation. Many industries are doing it, accounting is just starting. And those jobs are going to be automated. But then the jobs just become really more complex. The AI technology won't be good yet. Question, how is it going to be? I think there's going to be a while before it happens. And now, why did Amazon buy Whole Foods? Do you guys like Whole Foods? My daughter loves Whole Foods. She can't buy anything that doesn't cost twice as much as it's getting for my grandchildren. And I had a student here, okay, maybe 4 years ago, and he decided to do his project on organic food. And he had a brother or brother-in-law that actually ran a market in California for organic food. Okay, so he conducted an audit. Conducted an audit. He obviously got the name. He did a great job. He conducted an audit, and his conclusion that about half of the farms that claimed to be organic were not organic. Okay. And then the other part was the more disturbing part of this. The first one I suspected anyway, but the second one was that the FDA allows even the organic labeled things to have a lot of chemicals and antibiotics and etc. So the standards are not so non-organic.
Natural is unnatural.
Natural is not natural. And so my daughter cannot buy asparagus that doesn't cost twice as much as the regular asparagus. And I have this suspicion that it's all full of antibiotics. But anyway, I am required to go and buy organic milk. And it can't be in the store more than one day, so we kind of had to go and buy organic milk for them. They hate it too, so I said, I. Okay. But why did Amazon buy?
Maybe one reason is like Amazon doesn't really have a physical presence for showing they do a good job of not like the customer and the telephone, but maybe they wanted to show like a physical space where.
Did you say you don't think they do a good job?
No, they do a good job.
They do a very good job.
Very good job, yeah. Exceptional. But maybe they want like a physical presence to show consumers like what customer service means to them.
Johnny?
They bought Whole Foods just for the aspect of just delivering the food, because Whole Foods has like their own kind of things for delivery. So Amazon wanted to acquire that to expand their business.
Whole Foods is about 1.5% of the entire market. Very small compared with the government.
They're actually trying to cut ties, like stop the delivery.
Yeah, they picked up the,
it's not enough profit.
The cream of the market.
I buy for Whole Foods all the time. The truth is, if you want to use the delivery service, you'll have to buy not only the Amazon Prime, but also the Amazon Green, which is also cost you like $14.99 per month. Also, it also,
so what is the Amazon what?
It's called Amazon Green something.
Fresh.
Yeah, Amazon Fresh, exactly.
Fresh.
So, yeah, so if you want to use a delivery service from the Whole Foods or from other market, like for the food, like to deliver it to your door, like you have to buy the what, like in front of the Amazon Prime, which means you have to pay like two subscriptions fees. Yep, and also the thing is like the Whole Foods is for the people who is like educated people, who is like more like more demand, like pays more. So that means like for people like who wants to pay the two substitutions, they also want to get the like organic food, and that's like kind of like match from with like the Amazon and the Whole Foods.
So how many of you are Prime members? More than half. So I never figured out how Prime works. I thought it was $99 and now I think they increase it. Meaning I order $5 items all the time in Prime. Okay, I don't know how they can make any money on it. And now I didn't know they had Fresh, so I learned something. So that's how they're doing it. They are accumulating these different services. But again, my question is, why did they buy Whole Foods? And one of the answers here was, this is kind of end product, very high-end product, probably with higher margins.
Just buying Whole Foods highly gives Amazon a stranglehold on food delivery. The combined companies account for only 1.4% of American grocery market. The people shop at the chain are not the mass market. Mr. Bezos has made no big announcements about changes at Whole Foods.
I don't think he's doing big changes.
I kind of love the idea of drone deliveries,
but I don't think they're going to do it in the, you know, Denise Applebaum, I might even get her to come and talk to you guys. If she's here, don't make her come, because she's teaching. She graduated last year, and she's doing with us a project on drones for KPMG. Okay, and it's basically drones for audit. And if she can't show it, I'll show you the films. And she's very interesting. But the whole idea of drone deliveries is kind of cool. I love drones.
What comes to mind is that the whole grocery industry at the moment is sort of declining in a way. So perhaps
people stop eating.
No, not something. The prices and the profit that's being made at the moment. So I think it was perhaps some way of buying opportunity in the market on a whole. And then also I know Amazon has been testing automated stores where you walk in and knows who you are and identifies you electronically. So almost taking perhaps, I bet you, again, a theory, 10 years from now, there'll be stores where there's no labor in it. It's all electronic. Robots are the ones moving the inventory around, as you saw in your video, and that'll be the business model that sort of takes over and is profitable.
In stores with no people, so anyone can go in, take whatever they want, and leave,
they have it in Seattle.
In our store?
No, because there's camera, the whole sensors, all everything you just shared with us.
Cool.
You don't even have to do anything to check in or check out. There is no, you just put it in, you go,
stable, your margins get bigger, and you can incur bigger losses or rather. Is that a rationale? I think you're right. I think this kind of thing is going to evolve much more. I don't think that's why they want whole food. I think it was just one of the sectors they haven't been in, and they want to be everywhere. Amazon has a very good attitude about profit. They do long-term profits. They for the last, I don't know, 10 or 12 years, they always lost money. But the market share keeps expanding.
Yeah, and also,
of
course, the industry, the healthy profits are not, this is highly relevant right now because everybody is trying to be healthy. It's good to be healthy, grow up, like a healthy lifestyle to be fit. So I feel like Amazon invested in
it. So you're basically saying that this is a growth area, this health.
Yeah.
So the United States pushes all demographic characteristics surrounding neighborhoods. And you guys were right. Basically, this is a problem for the rich. Okay, household income over $100,000. Education, bachelor degree plus. You see, less than high school, this. Bachelor degree plus. Over $100,000. Less than $25,000. Age. Kind of similar. So when they bought shares of Walmart and Kroger sink rapidly and still came back recently, Amazon Whole Foods is important not for it to represent, but how it might transform Amazon. A growing share of office supplies and clothes are bought online. Yet last year, e-commerce accounted for just 2% of American spending in food supplies. Why is it? How many of you order online for food? No one? You do. Okay. And what kind? You order everything online or just canned goods, an example?
No, just cooked food. I order that for noodles.
So everything?
Not everything.
Not only canned goods. How about you, Anne?
I tried fresh direct from Amazon Fresh, but I didn't like that some of the products were not fresh, doesn't expire. So I better to.
Yes, blend matters a lot in online purchase, reputation. That's how I end up there.
Oh, no, I was just going to talk about Amazon Fresh. They deliver a variety of products that you get anywhere from like milk, cheese, fruit, to even like box food, canned food, stuff like that.
Actually, I think this is the answer why they went for Whole Food. It's a market that they haven't been there. Okay, it's a big amount market. And I always kind of wondered why they didn't eliminate the store. Okay, the stores are very expensive to maintain, very labor intensive. If you get rid of that, go to distribution warehouses, provisioned with the little robots that you saw. Okay, and just ship it. Probably they could decrease the cost of that. And I never really understood why they haven't done that yet. Something is wrong with my reasoning, but I never really understood why they haven't. Because there are a large amount of money spent on groceries. Okay. So these are. Groceries margins are low and it's good, devilishly hard to deliver. You see, peaches, booze, this is what my wife says. You can't buy fruits and vegetables on the internet. I say, why not? But she is in charge, so I keep my mouth shut or it becomes my job. Okay, meat rot. Many consumers like my food in person. Or like choosing a battery, a book, a selected tomato, requires a snack. I always talk about my mother-in-law, about rest her soul. When she bought watermelon, she bounced the watermelon. She hit it to see her and bounced it to buy the watermelon. And she squeezed chicken, life, and things like that. This is Hong Kong buying habits. Okay? And so maybe she, and my wife behaved. My wife won't order anything. But when there is a drug for mochi that is very expensive on the pharmacy, she said, can you go look at it for me, see if you can buy it? So I got and go to one, chewy.com, and buy it because it saved one third of the price. Okay, so this is actually what they call second economy. Other people have done. They digitization create a second economy that's fast, automatic, invisible, bringing a bigger change to industrial revolution. Okay. And so we already talked about this, actually, this is the same quote that I showed originally when they were talking about general purpose and technologies. Okay, there's a bunch of things. Okay. Just a little bit of a question about your smartphone. Before I go ahead on this, I want to ask you, how does your smartphone going to look 5 to 10 years in the future? What features is it going to have? What are you going to do with it? Anyway, you can guess as well as I. Maybe not. Let's see. What's the most annoying thing about your smartphone these days?
Battery life.
Okay, that's very annoying, I agree. What else is very annoying?
Storage.
You need to carry it.
You need to carry it and you lose it. Yes. What else is very annoying?
The screen cracks.
Yeah, screen cracks is very annoying. But the most annoying thing is it's small, correct? Wouldn't you like to have a device that is small, but you can make it big? You can see well, you can surf it. Don't you reserve things to look at your computer because the cell phone is too small?
Yeah.
Don't you wait until you open files, until you get a computer? Because, and you know, the people that don't have computers have a problem. So what, Brenda, what would you do? RFID under your skin to identify you so you don't need to sign on?
Yeah, like it was like going through a door, like you just put your hand in. So I feel like at some point it might be the same with phones.
So signing out on is annoying to you?
Not to me, but like to people.
No, not to you. It's annoying to me. But I think face recognition is quite good, actually, these days. That's not too bad. I think it's the size is the main issue.
Yep.
Yeah.
I think software updates are kind of annoying, too.
Well, okay, let's talk about size. About the software updates. This is PiggyBank. One application on top of the other. The moment you do updates on these things, you are giving access to your computer, to your cell phone, to a third party. And as much as good as they are in protecting you, there is a risk. You turn on your PC in the morning, you just open it in the morning, all kinds of entities like Microsoft updated your computer. Do they have this gentleman's voice? Yes. Do they have ex-employees? Yes. Do they have backdoors on their software? They do. And so updates is a big, big problem. And is it going to go away?
Yes.
No. Because the platforms are being sold. And the platforms evolve. And you have to evolve the software with the platforms. other interesting issue is about new companies and old companies. You go into Microsoft, they cannot create a revolutionary software. Why? Because they have to keep compatible with the past versions. Now, if it's a disruptive company starting a total new thing, they don't have to keep coherent. Even Apple has to be coherent with the past Apples and do certain things to be coherent. So, software company exists for a little while, they are totally hamstrung by the products. And in the products, there are these many generations of things they need to support and to be competitive. And every one of the generation might have a backdoor, might have a legal entry, or might have a weird update. And you know, how many of the softwares that got updated in your computer don't work? Why? Does it happen that they don't work as well as they test? Yes or no?
Yes. Yes.
Very often they don't work, correct? And then you restart the computer, you do some magic, sometimes works. Why? Because your configuration wasn't the kind of standard one that they tested and the variations that they tested. So this, you are eaten. You are totally right. Updates are a big problem, mainly in the cybersecurity area, but also in the compatibility area. And I think the problem is that cell phones are going to evolve with that. Okay, and so this is kind of talking about the number of devices. Devices in use in 93, 100 million. In 2008, basically PCs, 1 million. And in 2020, 110 million probably already are there. 20 million of iPhones. But this is, I think, was a Goldman Sachs study. And this basically talks about different countries and their connection. It's difficult to find these studies. But this is about, I wanted to show you this. And this is actually the elements of components on a Samsung maybe 3 years ago. And you can see is Infineon Taiwan, Murata Japan Tire, Skybox, all of these supply goodies for Samsung. And then I had also this for Apple's. And if you look at it, what do you conclude out of this? Each one of these could be a liability, could be a cybersecurity risk, and look where it comes from. Did you realize that your cell phone is multilingual, multi-country? And the total cost of components for, let's say, a $300 phone here was $170. Can't make too much money out of this. So you have to find other ways to make money. And this is Apple, and this was, I think, the Apple 5, if I recall correctly. Sales price $560. Apple gets this much, and the rest of it is Foxconn and the components. And this is market share, and if you see that this is not anymore this way. Apple lost a little bit of market share in here. Okay, this next type of thing is I wanted to talk to you about this idea of ecosystem. What is an ecosystem? You buy Kindle. You know what Kindle is? Okay, what is Kindle? Books, electronic books. So does it have an ecosystem? Yes, there's software that delivers the product. It has a provider that gives the product to the home. It has suppliers that give you the books, just to begin. And then you start thinking there is a whole entire ecosystem that feeds Same thing on your cell phone, same thing on a lot of electronic things. There is a whole supply industry. We looked at this, and this is an ecosystem of components, and there is a whole ecosystem of apps being applied. Okay, and this is quite old, but I didn't have a more updated here to show you, is number of apps available in second quarter 2011 for Apple Store. You know how many they have now? They have probably some in the millions. And downloads in the billions in 13. Most popular category. This is still that. Games. And most popular in Apple. Okay, this is actually an issue still in business. Is your device yours? Is your device the company's? And some companies give you your cell phone, some companies give you computers to use, and there are rules about that. If they belong to the company, the company basically owns everything contained in. And so people carry like three phones, one for himself, one for the company, one for the manufacturer, and et cetera. And actually become much more popular these days to companies to give devices out to people. And this is about high wear, things that you wear. And this is, you know, one of the markets that I actually am surprised has developed very slowly. Meaning Fitbits are common, but any one of you wearing clothes that are electronic? Not yet. Okay, they have kind of prototypes of clothes that change colors, clothes that you have different patterns, and this hasn't evolved. People don't like them very much. Maybe they just, yes.
You just mentioned personal phones, business phones, and that kind of thing. I was always curious why something ever shifted where you could get three different phone numbers to your same phone.
Oh, you still can do that. You still can do that, not very commonly, but there are phones that allow you.
But why isn't there then when you're making a phone call, say it's my phone, I'm making a personal phone call now, anything work-related, I wish the phone could recognize, all right, that's work, and almost file it software-wise, like in that area of the phone. So therefore, the company owns just that, and then you don't have to worry about the other app that's your personal, and not have to carry.
You know what you just did?
Like that.
You just said that there is a problem here to be developed that you can make a lot of money on. This is how new ideas on product come out. It's something you would like to use.
It's on the camera, right there.
Okay, now this is where it starts. It starts with chronic ailments because people are going to invest on that, and there'll be a reason for that, and then it becomes common. Cardiac devices. I actually have a bathroom scale that connects to my Fitbit. But it's not complete ecosystem. I am happy with it. Because every day when I take my pulse and my blood pressure and that scale, the scale is collected by my Fitbit, goes in fast. But those devices don't go into a spreadsheet, the thing I have home. Okay? So it's not integrated, it doesn't have an ecosystem yet. And Nike actually started with several wearable devices. But they're not selling very hard. Let's see what happens in the future. Okay, you've seen all the jump on devices, and they are a little bit like when about Netflix and et cetera, they have a pile of devices. Now, this is something I did years ago, and this is an electronization index. I worked with one of the consulting firms digitization index. And actually we went cycle by cycle, and this is an example, CAD, and found indices that measured how well they were doing in creating electronic presence, creating the cycle. And it was actually very good for them, not for the reasons I thought, but was very good for selling services. They would go and see the company's activity, calculate the index, and show you guys are doing very poorly here. So we can help. So it was actually quite interesting doing this with them. And that part of the business I wasn't that interested in. I wrote my paper and left. And this is actually quite old, but I like this a lot. This is Cisco. And I borrowed this slide also from Cisco's guys. And this is actually their investment 1 year in creating, improving the electronic presence. And they calculated they needed to invest $50 million one time and then $10 million annually to change the customer service, the sales order, marketing, procurement. And these were the different applications that they developed. And although this is dated, actually firms continue doing this. This is a digitization strategy, trying to create economies in every part of the value chain. It's quite interesting example. Now, a couple of theoretical considerations. And this is what I talked before, the biddable and non-biddable good. What is a biddable good? It's a good that can be transmitted over the internet. And those, like music, software, education, really don't need physical transfer. The other part is there are things that are commodities electronically, other things that are not commodities. You know, you started talking about buying groceries on the internet, and no one would have too much of a concern buying a canned good. Basically, it's price and not being expired. Reputable store to order selling that. However, bananas or any meat or et cetera, people would be very worried about that. So what is an e-commodity? An e-commodity is something that is easy to sell over the internet, is a commodity, like a can, and the other thing. Now, if you were going to an expensive dress store, and buy a designer dress, would you buy it without trying it?
We'll try.
Probably not. Huh? Okay, so you're already more, you know, this is what I do. I buy, if I have to buy a jacket, I buy it in Brooks Brother, and I don't like it, I just put it there, put the label on it, doesn't cost me anything, return it. I buy some of them, they hit me, and then I continue doing that. Okay, but if you were a lady in South America, with in a farm in Mato Grosso, Brazil, you have good seamstresses. Look, you go on the internet, you choose what you like, you buy it, and then locally you adjust it. So there are contingencies that change your buying habit, and these are very interesting to talk. And it finishes up the biddable goods that are e-commodities, are the things that sell the best. And that's why brokerage, travel, etc., evolve the way it is. Now, there are other types of markets, and you don't think about them, but one is the business to consumer market, that's the one you are very used to. And then there is market B2B that you haven't seen very much. However, B2B is like large part of things you're going to account and audit for. So those are very large markets. Okay, let me move ahead here. I'm going to skip some things. Okay.
Okay, just a few axioms and then I will let you go. It's getting late. Okay, the first thing is controlling the value chain. And basically what you have is upstream system, downstream system, and a company. The company adds something to this value. And so this is the ideal situation for a company like Amazon. Why? Because Amazon started whereby there were many suppliers, many customers, and what was Amazon? Amazon was an intermediary. So what was the value being added? Started with books. And what was the value being added? They picked up with the databases of the suppliers, blocked the databases into Amazon, and created an interface for the customers. And when a sale was effected, it went directly from the supplier to the customer. So the Amazon boxes you have very often are not at Amazon, but they are in the suppliers. And so they really didn't have physical transit of goods. They are a margin player taking a little bit of margin for selling a good for a third party. And this is actually the ideal situation, the intermediary situation. Now, after a while they discovered, and I mentioned this before, that there are 500 or 600 items that they knew was going to sell. So why pay the suppliers for that? Why didn't they get the money for the suppliers? So they created big warehouses and went into this business, and they did very poorly. They just didn't have the supply chain expertise. But now they're doing okay with that business, make a lot of money on it. Now there are other situations, and let me just kind of talk about them, where there are few suppliers and many customers. Allies. Okay, there are not that many allies. And in a local flight, etc., there are very few. So what happens in that situation? These guys dominate the value chain. So the airlines basically control prices and control the supply chain. The opposite happens, for example, in car manufacturing. They are the few buyers of car parts. So what happens? GM, Ford, etc. control the supply chain. So they created an interface called provinces, what was basically a business-to-business market, whereby the car manufacturers control. There were thousands of car part suppliers, and just a few car companies. And then the other thing is that the traditional product, for example, Volvo has had pretty much its entire production line in Gothenburg, Sweden. And with the internet and the common platform, they can break it down and provide it in different places. Didn't have to be in one place. They actually continued pretty much go to go. But this is actually what's happening today. We're talking about outsourcing. We didn't use those words, but we're talking about outsourcing of products over the internet, and basically that the manufacturing is coming back in the US. And what is the story there? The story is that it was much cheaper to manufacture in China and sell it in the US. But what is the cost? Transporting it back. And then the logistics. And then the platforms. And with the internet, the platform came together.
So it doesn't matter where your location is, you have one database. That's pretty good. Then the other thing happened, that manufacturing there became more expensive, and here became cheaper. And so people are rethinking the outsourcing and saying, you know, it's always better to be close to your client because you don't need to transport it. So maybe it's a bit more expensive, labor expensive in the US, but we put robots in there and we don't transport things. So that's kind of the reversal of what's happening, but they're basically facilitated by allowing different ways to supply the content. You don't have to do it at the same place. The third thing is integration of products. And this hasn't happened the way I expected it, but is evolving in that direction. A manufacturer sees itself as a supplier of a particular good. The best example, actually, is cars. Where do you spend money in your car? Is it in the purchase of your car?
Ownership.
Think about the lifetime of your car. Let's say average car lives around 12 years. Suppose you never sold a car, the car bought it new. What were your costs?
Maintenance, service, gas.
Yeah, actually probably gas is the biggest one. And then maintenance service comes into their insurance very large over time. And so the car manufacturer really have the car sale and spare parts. Spare parts are large part of profit. Implements are small. Financing can be quite big over the life of the car. Maintenance actually, in relative terms, is not that much. So when we are working with Volvo, we kind of try to develop ideas on how to do this. And one of the ideas was like the Citibank bicycle model now in the city, was they never sold the car. They would sell mileage to the car, and you would get in an app in an airport and just pick up a Volvo and drive and pay by mile.
Isn't that Zipcar?
Huh?
Zipcar model.
Yeah. This is before Zipcar, good point. So that was the model that they developed. They talked about it. We did this kind of ideation exercise with them and et cetera. And they came out with this idea. And it was a pretty cool idea. And they never did it because they are in Volvo, and Volvo was part of Ford at that time, and there was a lot of turmoil. And they said, well, kind of a nice idea. Don't sell a car, sell the usage of a car. And at that time, you're not only selling the car, but you're selling gas and you're selling insurance. It's all your product. Pretty nice, correct? It's the aggregation product. And this hasn't happened as fast as I expected, but it's happening, integrated. And it's ask not what product you made, ask what you do for